my pleasure to introduce the 2012 William Willis speaker this evening, Professor Hua Cheng Guan, who is a familiar face and name to most of us. Professor Hua began his career in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs before being posted to the Ministry of Defense. In 1969, he was commissioned into the Singapore Armed Forces. In the mid-1980s, he was tasked with reorganizing the Oral History Center and the Old National Museum, and he led the process of forming three museums, the Asian Civilizations Museum, the Singapore Art Museum, and the National Museum of Singapore under the National Heritage Board. Currently, Professor Hua is on the boards of the National Heritage Board, the Asian Civilizations Museum, including chairing a very important acquisition subcommittee, and is the chairman of the National Archives Board. He was the founding chairman of the National Atlantic Museum and was a consultant to the Millennium Heritage Foundation and helped the Singapore Armed Forces plan and create the Army Museum. His other posts have included teaching history at the National Institute of Education and the National University of Singapore. Professor Hua is head of the external programs at the S. Rajaratnam School of International Studies at NTU, where he's involved in regional security projects related to energy, security, and regional security crisis management. And he co-teaches the Singapore Studies module at NUS. Tonight's talk will feature the Arts of Angkor and the ongoing challenge to more precisely date these ancient monuments by analyzing their style. The Siao's founding president, William Willis, was interested in Angkor, and Professor Hua has also researched, written, and lectured extensively on the subject of dating Angkor and pre-Angkor art. He spoke most recently to an archaeology field school conducted by our staff member John Music, and he and his wife Nellie are longtime members of SIAS. Professor Hua spoke once before at SIAS in 2004 on Indianization of Southeast Asia. It's a great honor to welcome Professor Hua this evening to deliver the annual lecture. Professor Hua.
Thank you for that very generous introduction. It's a bit more than what my second few days I thought that. And thank you all for coming. I didn't expect this large audience here. I'm of course delighted to be delivering the second time this William Willis lecture in honor of my own professor. It's humbling to remember that I knew him some 3 years before the society was founded. And I believe in this audience only Prof. Wang Gan-guo has the honor of having personally met William Willis. Willis was for me still the most memorable lecturer of my university days, simply because I think about the subject and also the way he taught it. The dozen or so of us who signed up for the course would gather in the university art museum and gallery, and then two big screens and two huge projectors. Light projectors. Those were the days when you had to use light projectors and Willis used medium format projectors, not the little 35 and whites. So we all gather, sit around there for an hour. Willis would come in looking and looking just about out of bed 10 minutes ago and all the ruffle of his head, his clothes all ruffled. Exactly as you see in there, you know, straight mark short and his and slippers, never washed. So Willis got that start of that from the 7 years he spent in India. As I gather, he was a biology student, but an interest in Chinese art developed, and he switched careers and studied classical Chinese and Chinese art. And in 1957, he wrote a book, Chinese Art, which was published by Penguin. And apparently on the basis of the royalties of naval they got, and sailed east, landing in India. Whether that year they intended to go to China, as a matter of fact, doubting very much, given the political conditions. And there in India, South India, Chennai, for Madras, 3 days, he spent the next few years before he was recruited by the then University of Singapore to take over from Michael Sullivan the course on art history, given his Indian background, I think it was inevitable that Willis would have been drawn to a core. And even as a student, when I was with him in the afternoons, I would see him working on what he claimed was a guidebook to a core. Unfortunately, that never saw the light of day. And it's interesting to see what core that guidebook would have taken if ever materialized. So this is the only photo I think we have of Willis at somewhere in Kamkor. He of course took a large number of slides for his book and his lectures, but unfortunately those slides have long been lost when the University Art Museum was closed down and its collections transferred out. So, on the issue of Kamkor, I think we are still stuck with this problem there. The initial problem was when, for the early 19th century French explorers who built these monuments of Angkor, they just don't think the jungle of unexpected, some lost civilizations. When were they built and for what purposes? The whole issue is what are we looking at? And here you see two lithographs from what like the French explorers. In fact, one of them, I think, Mahmoud, even thought that they wore reassemblances to the Sphinx in Egypt in those days and wondered whether there was a connection between the two. So, for the French archaeologists and scholars of the Français, as George said, they so wonderfully summed it up, the task of the earliest historians was simply to put in place a chronology of kings and their monuments. And Sedes wrote, I think, what is probably one of the best little guidebooks on Angkor. I think there is an English translation of it in Oxford or print. And there you see the man Sedes himself, a very small little figure. So if you zero in to one of the key monuments of Angkor, the Bayon. Now, what then are we looking at in the Bayon? Are we seeing a four-faced Brahma, or Brahma difficult to put iconography on four faces, or are we seeing a five-faced Shiva? Or, as people at Hormuz have argued, we are seeing the form of Lakshmana, Buddhist Lord of the universe here, or a crowned Buddha, is also our Moses' view. And when was the monument built? If you compare it to Angkor Wat, both of the best forms of Khmer culture, Bayon before that, built early in the 9th century, or a later monument, because the building techniques were not as good as